technique, but it's, surgically I'm happy. Moving to the body. Everything's moving in the body. You got the liver moving, you got the kidneys moving, and everything like this. So let's see if we can do functional body imaging, because that's where I want to try to focus things around oncology. So why study mold in the body? Okay, well, here's a good case I did when I was as a clinical physicist at SickKids. Another 12-year-old boy with a big tumor in the distal head of the femur. It's an osteosarcoma. In this case, we give an injection of gadolinium contrast. It brightens up the tumor, and we can do all kinds of mathematical modeling to find out what's happening with this tumor. So this particular case, here's another one of these sarcomas. You know, I wrote some software that give us an indication of the microvascular permeability of the tumor. This case here, the physicians wanted to know what this thing was, because if that's a bad thing as well, then they'd have to consider their therapy a bit more differently. Okay, there's another maybe tumor, but that happened to be benign. You look at the enhancement here is very slow versus the aggressive tumors, very, very rapid wash in, wash out. So we can get a new dimension in what's going on with these kinds of tumors. Okay, that's great. We can do that. But the only problem, the caveat with doing that is these dynamic contrast enhanced approaches are a snapshot. You inject, you've got a few seconds to collect the data, and it's all over with. Okay. So what about the tumor more in a dynamic sense? And these mathematical models surrounding these perfusion scans, we call them, are very, very complicated, and there's a whole host of different models. And, you sit there going, well, which one is the correct model to use? Okay, so that, that there's some caveats around doing single-shot dynamic. I mean, it's still a great technique, don't get me wrong. The other thing that's come up is this nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, which is a relatively newly described disorder. People that get injected with gadolinium contrast for MRI, some of them have died, and there's some issues around like a toughening of the skin, et cetera, et cetera. You know, we used to be very cavalier with injecting gadolinium to ourselves. I've been injected 20 times, and I was like, woohoo, I'm in the 20 club, it's, but we can't do that anymore, because we now know there are some toxic side effects that may or may not, come to light. So we wanted to get away from injecting, and besides, who wants to be injected anyway, okay, except for maybe silly people like myself. So we want to get away from that. So let's go to BOLD scanning, because we can use BOLD to dynamically assess all kinds of things. The tissue response to stimuli, yes. Metabolism, microcirculation, oxygenation in the tissues. And we can do it over and over and over again. We don't have to worry about putting needles in, and people don't mind it. Okay, so let's go to that. So I'm going to show you a couple bits of functional imaging we can do. So kidney, for example. Kidney is one of the worst ones at St. Joe's, where I work in Hamilton. There's a lot of people with kidney disorders there. And indeed, the people with nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, a lot of them are kidney patients. So I really wanted an idea we can work on with kidneys. But the kidneys move, okay? So that's a problem. Okay, so no problem. We can also we can deal with the motion, and we can also activate the kidneys. Think about it. Your kidneys work to reabsorb water. I mean, if you didn't, that's one of the main functions of kidneys. So when the kidneys are really, if you're dehydrated, your kidneys are expending more energy to reabsorb the water into your body. Okay. If you load up the water, your kidneys kind of take a rest and say, I don't need this water. Let's not reabsorb it. Let's get rid of it. Okay. So that's the kind of the premise behind this technique. So what we did was we did just free breathing. Kidney imaging with this BOLD technique, and we loaded up a lot of Gatorade and water. We didn't want to upset the ion balance in the body, and we just did real-time imaging. And one of the problems, as I said, is motion. Well, we imaged in this plane right here, sort of a kind of an oblique plane through the kidneys, just to make sure that any motion would stay in plane. And here's a nice movie. And we wrote some nice software to do pattern matching. Now, I changed the contrast in this image because it's looking for the edges of the particular object. The object we're tracking is the yellow object, and this person's free breathing, okay? So we can then extract the data after we've acquired all the data, and then we're left with a nice rock-solid steady image. And then we can do some nice mathematics on that. I won't get into all the nuts and bolts of the math, but you can see very clearly right here the cortex has a lot more change after you do water loading. So basically you see an increase in oxygenation in the healthy cortex following water loading. It's representing the very healthy kidney. We're right now getting results on diseased kidneys and how diseased kidneys or even transplanted kidneys are not going to potentially behave this way. Muscle imaging is another one we've been working on. So here's muscle before and after some exercise, just as one example. Now, how do you exercise? They always tell you in MRI you got to be still. So here's an example of what we have in the imaging center in St. Joe's. We have a bicycle that goes inside the MRI. And I just purchased this with some funds I got from the CFI. So we get patients or people that go inside the MRI and they start pedaling the bike. Okay, and it sounds kind of crazy, but no, we're doing stuff in real time so we can deal with this. Okay, we want to see functioning tissues. What better way to make a muscle function than to exercise? My good friend and colleague Greg Wells at SickKids has the same machine, and we're doing a whole bunch of parallel studies on children with cystic fibrosis, children with diabetes, and we're doing stuff the same way at our place as well. Okay, so we have parallel studies going on with this. And here's an example of one of the subjects. They're going to go in the magnet, so it's the same kind of system. Okay, so we want to get functional muscle. We've done tons of studies on muscle, on healthy muscle, and changing things in the microcirculation. An example is with nicotine, you see the soleus muscle activating, and then after exercise, that exercises specifically the soleus, you see an elevation in the activation of that muscle. So we are sensitive to metabolic changes in the tissue with this particular type of technique. Now, we can do all kinds of fun stuff. Now, the engineers in the crowd will love this. They'll say, oh, my, we got some Fourier transform going on. Beautiful. That's the kind of bread and butter stuff we do in engineering. We can take this bold signal and do a Fourier transform, and we can see frequencies that are representing physiologic things, like the heart rate or the respiratory rate, which we'll see down here in this healthy muscle. In the case of something called compartment syndrome, the muscle strangulates itself when it's exercising. So when you actually do a Fourier transform on that kind of bold signal, the physiologic signals are gone because the muscle is actually strangulating itself. Okay, we did a lot of work on this and found it very fun and very exciting. But I want to get a new thing to you just to show you where we're really driving, because engineers like something called LTI systems, linear time invariant systems. And if you go through engineering, all you learn is the world is linear, okay? It isn't when you go to biology. When you go to biology, throw the linear stuff away, because that stuff is not going to work anymore. So the best way to deal with biological systems is delve into the realm of chaos. And I've read so many textbooks on this, and it really, really does work. I'm not going to get into the math, okay? So if anyone wants to talk to me later, I'll be happy. But let's start first by talking about fractals, because fractals and chaos are very, very intimately related. So a fractal dimension of something like 1... this is dimensions, or Euclidean dimensions are what we're used to, things that have three-dimensional shape. Well, this is dimensions that go between those kind of dimensions, and they describe the complexity of a system. So like a circle or a straight line will have a fractal dimension of 1, meaning it's very periodic. And you get into these very, very fun shapes like the Koch snowflake, and they'll get other types of fractal dimensions. And we can use this to quantify signals in time. So essentially, if you're looking at a branching structure, like a broccoli or something like that, it's got a fractal dimension based on its complexity of its branching structure. You can also look at the complexity of signals the same way and look for similarity at multiple scales. So if you look at a signal like this, it looks pretty messy. If you zoom in on it, it looks messy. If you zoom in on it again, it looks still messy. Okay, I don't see anything in there that will go, oh, there's a sine wave or anything. It's just a messy signal. So you can categorize this type of signal with fractals and with chaos theory. So if you get a fractal of 1 in a signal, it's a periodic signal. If you get a fractal closer to 1.5, you're delving into the realm of chaos. Okay, so how can we deal with this with muscle? Again, getting away from injections. So here's just a simple muscle image of the lower leg and a bold image. And then here we've done some fractal mapping using chaos theory, a muscle before and after exercise, and I think it's pretty obvious that it's very different. The fractal dimension drives to 1, meaning it's very periodic. These muscles have blood pulsing through the tissue, boom, boom, okay? Very periodic signal. And that's how we can look at signals. We can see blood pulsing, which means high blood flow, which is correlated to some situations in disease. Okay, we've done things like exercise, we've done deep tissue massage, Swedish massage. I had no shortage of volunteers in my lab for that. But you can see there's a very clear difference in the muscles in the back. We can see a decrease.